Say, we give you all glory.
We give you all.
Come on, let's worship him.
The
he deserves all the praise. Come on. God's been good to you. You could have been dead. You could have been sick in your body, laying on your sick bed. Come on. He's worthy to be praised. So let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Come on. You don't want to rock the crowd for you.
Hello, and thanks for returning for another edition of God's End Time Message. I'm Pastor Earl Jones with Refuge Temple Ministries here in Humble, Texas. And we'll continue our second day of discussion on the topic, Jesus, the Son of God. Now, what is the relationship of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost? Well, you'll get the answers to these questions in this episode. So please stay tuned and also invite others to watch this very important broadcast. Our instructors today are Pastor Jonas Alexander and Pastor Lynn Roberts.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Pastor Jones. And good afternoon, everyone. And welcome back to our spiritual growth portion of our broadcast. As Amen. Pastor Jones was saying this afternoon, we're going to continue on Jesus is the Son of God. And this afternoon, talking about the relationship between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. As Pastor Jones was saying, my name is Brother Jonas Alexander. I'm one of the pastors here at the Humble, Texas Refuge Temple Ministries location. And this afternoon with me, I have Pastor Lynn Roberts, also of Houston, Amen. Texas. Amen, amen. And we're glad to be with you this afternoon. I'm going to do a little bit of a recap for some of you about what we were talking about on yesterday in relationship to Jesus being the Son of God. It'd be a great idea if you would go back and review those lessons on that so that you'll be right in line with what we're talking about this afternoon. So on yesterday, we discussed in Jesus being the Son of God, we talked about him being in subjection to the Lord. We talked a lot about the Gospel of John in chapter 17, and showing you how that over and over again, the Lord is talking about who gave him the words that he spoke, also who gave him the disciples that he had. He showed his subjection by even praying. The prayer, the act of praying itself showed who was ultimately in authority. Pastor Mike also talked about how Jesus said things and talking about ascending into heaven to be with his Father and his God. So it showed us there he could not be himself down here wrapped in the flesh, and he was saying that he was going to ascend up to where the Father presently resided. We talked about, we also talked about Jesus in John 17 said several times at the end of that prayer, he discussed the love that God had for him from the foundation of the world. And so we saw there again the love that that Father had for his Son. Not the love that the Father had for himself, but that he had for his Son. A totally different and a totally different being than himself. Then we also talked about oneness. We looked into the definition of one. We looked into what Jesus was praying, to what degree did he want his disciples to be one and how that it paralleled to he and God being one. Not that Peter and John would be the same person, not that Bartholomew and Judas would be the same person, not that Simon and Peter would be the same person, but that they would be of the same kind and quality of Christians, of God followers, of examples, and also in their love that they show one toward another, one another. There should be no difference in these things. So that's what we talked about on yesterday. If you would go with me to the next slide, here's what we're going to be discussing today. In our objectives today, we're going to explain the relationship between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. We're going to show that according to the Bible, the Word was made flesh, and how this happened. Explain that Jesus was both Son of God and Son of Man. If you remember on yesterday, we were reading in 1 Timothy where it talks about there was one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. So we're going to be showing you that Son of Man and Son of God. Our next slide. So the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, how do they relate? So we're still going to be using a lot of the Gospel of John. We're going to start here in John chapter 1. Again, we read in John 17 several times where Jesus explained how that God had loved him from the foundation of the world. He also talked about the glory that God had put up on him from the foundation of the world. So let's look at that a little bit more. So John chapter 1. And verse 1, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And so we read in John chapter 17 where Jesus was talking about his disciples. And he said how that they believed that anything that he had, it was because God had given it to him. And he said, they also believe, as he said, that I proceeded forth from thee. So we understand that in the beginning was the Word. And we'll discuss this more today as well. And the Word was God. But Jesus said, I proceeded forth from thee. So though there was a physical separation, there was a location separation, there was never a separation in the sense of purpose. There was never a separation when it came to the love. But physically, there's a separation. Locality, there's a separation. He said, I proceeded forth and came from thee. So he's no longer up in heaven. And we talked about, that's why at the beginning of John 17, it talks about him looking into heaven and praying. He's looking back up to the place and the person that he proceeded from. And now he's praying to him. So that was in the beginning. And he was also with God in the beginning. He spoke of his love that God had for him and also spoke of the glory that was upon him before the foundation of the world. Now, let's look at the next slide that also speaks about this. This is Genesis chapter 1. Very familiar scripture with a lot of us, showing that he existed together with God from the beginning. Again, the glory that I had with you from the beginning, the love that you had for me from before the foundation of the world. Genesis chapter 1 and verse 26. Why did John say, without him was not anything made that was made? Genesis 1 and 26 shows us very clearly. And God said, let us make man. That's plural already, us. In our, again, plural, image, and after our likeness. So when we see that in Genesis, then we understand clearly what John is talking about and saying that he was with him, and without him, God didn't make anything that we see here made. He was together with him, and God was speaking in the term of us and our. Next slide. Now we're reading in Hebrews chapter 7. This helps us to make more sense of what we were saying yesterday and looking at Jesus' words and statements about how that he proceeded forth and came from God. So now we're reading Hebrews chapter 7 and verse 8. It says, and here men that die receive tithes, but there he that receiveth them of whom it was witnessed that he liveth. Now this is talking about Abraham coming back from a battle and meeting the high priest Melchizedek, who the Hebrew writer goes on to describe more. But what we're looking at today is going to be the how does one proceed forth from another. So it talks about how that Melchizedek received tithes of Abraham. But verse 9, it says, and as I may say, so say, Levi also, who receiveth tithes, paid tithes in Abraham, for he was yet in his loins, in the loins of his father, when Melchizedek met him. So we know that physically being manifested and coming forth, Levi was several generations later. And Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, then the sons of Jacob, Levi, then you go all the way down into Moses' time and talking about the house of Levi, the priest, and them receiving tithes. But he's making the point that while in Abraham, what Abraham did also accounted as Levi doing it. But we see through the word that Levi eventually proceeded forth. He was no longer in Abraham's loins. Abraham was his father. But it shows us now this son, this great grandson, now has proceeded out of Abraham. And so it's the same thing with you and I, our natural fathers. We proceed forth and we come from them. So I'm not Martin Alexander. I was in him. Now I have proceeded forth from him, and I am a different individual than him. But in relationship to God, as we talked about yesterday, Jesus is still of the same kind and quality and manner that God is, though he has proceeded forth and came from him. So now let's look at John chapter 8. And we'll look at more of this relationship between the Father and his Son, or a Father and his Son, because we're going to see Jesus make some parallels to the religious sect of the Jews at this time about a relationship between a father and his son. So John chapter 28 and verse 29. And he that sent me is with me. Now already we see a distinction. He that sent me, we talked a lot about being sent, him being sent yesterday, is with me. He didn't say, I am he. I'm just already here. He that sent me is with me. The Father hath not left me alone, for I do always those things that please him. So we talked about yesterday, who assigns work? Jesus in his prayer was saying, I have finished the work that you gave me to do. Now he's saying, I do always those things that please him. He's not pleasing himself because he's not God. He's the Son of God. A son or a daughter does those things that please their parents. At least they are supposed to. So Jesus is saying that same thing here. I do what pleases him. You do what pleases the person who is in authority. That's what you do at work. That's what you do in a family unit. You do what pleases the one in authority. Their authority is above any authority that they have given to you. And it says, as he spake these words, many believed on him. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. They answered him, we be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, you shall be made free? Now, they want to start talking about lineage, sonship. And Jesus is able to relate and minister and preach to them about this topic because he himself is the son of somebody. So Jesus answered them, verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committed sin is the servant of sin, and the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the son abideth forever. Next slide, please. Verse 36 of John 8. If the son therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. Says, I know that you are Abraham's seed, but you seek to kill me because my word hath no place in you. And this is going to be very important in the next verses. They're claiming Abraham's seed. He said, but yet your actions are that you are seeking to kill me. He said, I spake that which I speak that which I have seen with my father. So we just talked about how he's been with him from the beginning, that he made the world with him. And he says, I speak that which I have seen with my father. That is why he behaves like his father. He's seen his father's attributes and conduct and his way, his spirit. And he said, when I speak something to you, when I preach something to you, when I give you the word of God, I give you the gospel, the doctrine, I speak that which I have seen with my father. And you do that which you have seen with your father. So he's talking to them. He's not saying that their father and them is the same person. He's not saying that he and his father is the same person. He's, because of his position as a son, he's able to relate to them and let them know, I know exactly where you are. Because just like I do what I've witnessed, you're just doing what you've witnessed. If I'm doing it, I'm not witnessing it. I've got to be seeing another person doing something for me to be a witness, for me to say, I have seen something. Otherwise, I'm just doing it. It's me. If I can't be a witness to me robbing the bank. If I rob the bank, I rob the bank. I'm not a witness. I did it. If I say I saw someone else do it, I am a separate being from them, and I have observed that they did. So that's what he's saying. I've observed certain things of my father. That's how I behave. Your behavior is based on what you have observed from your father. Next slide. So in verse 39, it says, they answered and said unto him, Abraham is our father. Now, Jesus just talked about them doing what they've witnessed. So now they want to claim, well, we doing what we see, what we saw Abraham do. Jesus said unto them, if you were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. Remember, this is also in relation to Jesus and God. So we'll understand better when Jesus says things like, when you've seen me, you've seen the Father. He's saying about them that if they were the children of Abraham, they would do his works. He said, but you seek to kill me, a man that has told you the truth, which I have heard of God. Christ does not use guile. He's not trying to trick them into believing. I know I'm saying I've heard this, but really I didn't hear it because it originated with me. No, if he's saying that he heard this of God, he's letting us know that there is a difference between he and God. If I hear something that Pastor Lynn says, it's not something I said. Obviously, I'm talking about hearing something that another being has said, which I have heard of God. This did not Abraham. Abraham didn't try to kill people who told him the truth. So he says, you do the deeds of your father. Just like Christ, again, he's able to relate because he does the deeds of his father. It's because of his life he's able to relate and preach this message to these people. You do the deeds of your father. Then said they to him, we be not born of fornication. We have one father, even God. So now they've gone further than just claiming Abraham to be their father. Now they're saying God is our father. Now Jesus just talked to them about them wanting to kill him. That's gone in one ear and out the other, because now they've gone further than just claiming Abraham. Now they're saying, oh no, man, God is even our father. But I just talked to you about the sin you want to commit of killing me for simply telling you the truth. So if you can't be claiming Abraham as your father, you certainly cannot be claiming God as your father at this time. And Jesus said unto them, if God were your father, you would love me. For I proceeded forth and came from God. Same thing we read about in John 17. He's ministering that again. I proceeded forth. Levi proceeded forth. Came from Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. He's saying, I proceeded forth and came from God. Neither came I of myself. Again, this is not honest. If he is either God come down off of his throne and wrapped in the flesh, it is not honest to say, I didn't come of myself. Of course you did. You just decided to come here. If he is God, also just manifest in another form. This is still untrue to say, neither came I of myself. Yes, you did. You may have taken up on another form, but you made the decision to come yourself. But as we understand him to be the Son, a separate being, and in subjection to God, then we understand why he said, I did not come of myself, but he sent me. And you read that over and over again in what we were talking about yesterday. It says, why do you not understand my speech? Even because you cannot hear my word. You are of your father, the devil, and the lust of your father you will do, or the desires of your father you will do. As he said, I do always those things that please my father. His desires is what I do. You see me doing the same thing. He's saying now the same thing about them. It doesn't make any of them Lucifer himself. They not the devil because they behaving like the devil, but it does make the devil their father. Jesus does not become God because he's behaving the same way that God is, but it shows us God is his father. He was a murderer from the beginning. What does Jesus say he does? He said he gives life. But he says about the devil, he was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth because there is no truth in him. But about Jesus, it's said differently. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He said, when he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. But with Jesus, the Bible says God is love. Then Jesus shows us that same mannerism and characteristic of his father, just as these hateful, murderous, dishonest people are showing the characteristics of who he says is their father, not Abraham, not God, but the devil. Now, Pastor Lynn is going to talk to us more about the relationship between the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost, and also more about Jesus, that seed of God, and how it has been manifested to us. Pastor Lynn.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor. So if you would, let's go to the next slide, please. So we're talking about the Son of God, and we're going to look at John chapter 1, verse 14, if you will. Go ahead and turn there and just hold that place, because we'll be coming back to that scripture every now and then. And what John chapter 1, verse 14 says is, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So we see here, just by this one scripture, this reveals a lot about Jesus right here. Yeah. It says the Word became flesh. It doesn't say the Father became flesh. It doesn't say the Holy Ghost became flesh. It says, plain and simple, the Word became flesh. Amen. And the Word is referred to a lot throughout the scripture. So we understand that the Word is the Word of God. And also, let's take a look at this from a different perspective. What we want to bring out is that Jesus actually had two natures, if you will. He was the Son of God, and he was also the Son of Man. And coming as the Word, he came in the Son of Man. He walked in the Son of Man. He walked as a man on this earth, but he was the Word of God made flesh. And there's no other scripture that contradicts that. But look at this one scripture, okay? John chapter 1, verse 14. It said, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Now see, that right there hints at the Son of Man operating right here on this earth during his time. And look at the second part. And we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Now, Jesus was a man, and he looked just like other men. There wasn't anything extraordinary about him. We find from the Old Testament he was kind of an ordinary-looking person. And if you stood Jesus next to another person, perhaps except the way they dress, I mean, if they dressed modestly, let's say they both did, you wouldn't be able to tell the difference between Jesus and any other man. He was a man. But whenever they both got into predicaments and situations, and they went through their trials and tests and problems, you would find out that from Jesus came out godly responses. You would find out that there would be forgiveness coming out of him, that there would be no cursing. There would be blessings instead of cursing. There wouldn't be repayment, evil for evil. He would be helpful to his enemies, praying for them. Whereas suddenly you find out these two guys that look the same, this other one's going off on the ungodly side. He's doing things that we'd be ashamed to do as Christians. So as men, they're the same. It's what's on the inside that counts. And that's what Pastor Jonas did so well explaining, that Word of God on the inside came out and showed itself. And that's why they could say, not just looking at that man, but they could say, and we beheld his glory. They witnessed Jesus going through his trials and sufferings. They were witnesses to all the things that he went through, and they could testify right here that he was full of grace and truth. He was overflowing with it.
Amen.
So praise God. If we can, let's go to the next slide, please. So we're going to look at Luke chapter 1, verse 26 through 35, and I'm just going to read one verse from that, and we'll come back to that in just a minute. But we're also going to read out of Romans. And Luke chapter 1, let's look at verse 31 there. It's on the slide. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son and shalt call his name Jesus. Now, the operative word there is conceive. That indicates a beginning. And we know very well that God has no beginning. He has no end. So whatever is being talked about here, and we'll bring it out as we go along, conception indicates a beginning. And it even says, bring forth a son. So it's very clear it's talking about the Son of God having a beginning. And we're not talking about the Word. We're talking about that man, Jesus Christ. Now let's look at Romans chapter 1, verse 3 through 4. Concerning his son, and his son referring back to God, the Father, if we read that the previous scriptures on that. So concerning his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh. So see, right there, Paul is differentiating the flesh, okay, the man, the Son of Man. And look at verse 4, he follows it up with this, and declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead. Jesus Christ proved he was the Son of God because he came out of that grave. He proved that there was no sin in his life because he came out of that grave. He proved he is and was the Son of God because he came out of that grave. And it was according to the Spirit of holiness. It was the life that he lived his entire life without sin. So we find here, again, a differentiation between the man and the Spirit, the Son of Man and the Son of God. And as far as the flesh is concerned, we just read Luke 1:31. Behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son. And then in verse 3 there, it talks about the seed of David according to the flesh. Amen. Amen. As a matter of fact, the same thing happens with us. If we're born again, we have the old man is still there. But if we're born again, we're born of a spirit of holiness. And just like you could stand two people side by side and see what's inside them, so it should be with us too. That when we're provoked, when we're tempted, when things are going wrong, the only response that should come out of us is holiness, just like Jesus. Amen. If you will, next slide, please. So we're going to go through Luke chapter 1, verse 26 through 35. And on the slide there, we're looking at verse 26. And what we're talking about here is the process of the Word becoming flesh. We want to show that it was the Word that gave conception to Mary. Okay, and this is the angel Gabriel talking to Mary. Verse 26, and in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin espoused to a man, that means engaged, to a man named Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among men, among women, I'm sorry. Blessed art thou among women. So we see here that the angel pointed out that Joseph is of the house of David. And the reason why that's important is because it was through David that the promise of a Messiah would come. It started out where Eve was told that there will be a seed that will come from her. And there's that word seed from the very beginning. That will come from her, which will crush the serpent's head, but it'll bruise his heel. And then from Adam, it goes down through Noah, and then it comes up again, we find, with Abraham, and through his children, through Jacob and Judah, and finally David, and Jesus is that promise fulfilled. Amen. So here we have the angel talking to Mary. And next slide, please. So we're in Luke chapter 1, verse 29. And when she saw him, talking about the angel, when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this must be, or this should be. In verse 30, and the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son and shalt call his name Jesus. And I'd like to point out something here, that when the angel came, she had already found favor with God. She didn't receive favor because she's about to have a son. Just like Zacharias and Elizabeth with John the Baptist, they were already walking according to the commandments of God.
Amen.
They were already fulfilling the ordinances, and they were blameless before the Lord. That's why the Lord chose them. God was not going to put such He was not going to allow John the Baptist to be born into a household that was full of sin and turmoil and strife and ungodliness. He found people that were already walking that way. So when Mary has found favor here, it's not because of what's about to happen. It's because of what the life she's already lived.
Amen.
Amen. So, and one more thing here before we move. It says, thou shalt conceive. You see, she was the one that brought forth conception. God, through his word, fulfilled that part of that ovum, the egg, that needed to be completed for conception to occur. But Mary, it says right here, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and shall bring forth a son. So that is as much human as you can get, when the woman is actually the one that conceives that through the egg, the ovum that is in her. So we see here again that conception indicates a beginning, and God has no beginning, but the Son of Man does. Next slide, please. So we're still talking about the Word becoming flesh, and we're talking about the process of that happening. So let's look at Luke again. We're still in chapter 1, verse 32. He shall be great. Now, the angel is talking about Jesus once he's born. He shall be great and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Now, see, here again, if we look for it, we can find a differentiation between the Son of Man and the Son of God, the man and the spirit. And when it talks about the Son of the Highest, God is a spirit, and he's going to bring forth things just like himself. Mary is a human. She's going to bring forth things just like herself. And so he talks about God or the Son of the Highest. He also talks about there shall be no end. Those are godly qualities. Those are eternal qualities that only God has. And then look in green there. It shows the throne of David and reign over the house of Jacob. These are things promised to a man, David, and they're carried out through Christ. So we have there the Son of God and the Son of Man. Next slide, please.
So, amen, Pastor Lynn. So one, and what I notice in this scripture that you're reading is one that he says, he shall be called great and shall be called the Son of the Highest. Again, it shows that authority.
Amen.
That God is literally, it said, the highest, and he's the Son of. Not that he shall be called the highest, or he shall be equal with the highest. He shall be called the Son of the Highest.
Amen.
God himself is the highest. His son is high because that's his son. If you're the highest and you have a son, that son is high. If a king has a son, that son has great authority because that is the prince. But God is called the highest. The other thing that I notice about this, Pastor Lynn, is that it does not tell her she will be the mother of God.
That's right.
It does not say that David is the father of God.
That's right.
As you said, he's the Son of God in spirit. That's why Jesus said in a parable that he put to them, howbeit in spirit, David calleth him Lord. He is the son of David after the flesh, but in the spirit, because he is the Son of the Highest, as we were talking about yesterday. David said, the Lord said unto my Lord, the Highest said to my Lord, sit thou at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool. He didn't have the power to make his enemies the footstool. The Highest had the power to do it and told him, as a father would tell a son, you sit here till I do it. As a mother would tell her daughter, you sit here until I'm ready to do it.
Amen.
So He is the Son of the Highest, so he's not as high as God. God is the highest, and he's also, Mary, I should say, is not called the mother of the highest.
That's right.
She is not called the mother of God. David is not called the father of the highest or the father of God. Pastor Lynn.
Amen. That's excellent. That reminds me of when Joseph was in Egypt with Pharaoh. Pharaoh said that Joseph will be highest in the kingdom except for the throne.
Yes.
He's not getting that one.
Yes.
But he'll be the highest in the kingdom except for me and my throne.
Amen.
And that parallels that very well.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Thank you, sir.
Amen.
Anytime, Pastor. You just. Amen. So we're going to go to the next slide. So where we're at right now is we're at Luke chapter 1, verse 34 on that slide right there. So let's read verse 34. Now, we're just continuing down this whole passage. If you're in Luke, you'll just be able to read straight through. So here in verse 34, it says, "And Mary said unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing I know not a man?" Now, see, Mary understood she's got to have a man in the process. Or Mary understood that conception required her womb to be impregnated by the seed of a man. She understood that very well. And she, the only thing she knew is that it came from men. She had no other understanding about what God was talking about. So he had to clarify it. And verse number, if you will, next slide, verse 35. So the angel explains it. The angel said, the angel answered and said unto her, "The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore, that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God." Jesus was begotten of the Father. Now here it says the Holy Ghost. If there are really three up there, Father, Son, Holy Ghost, why would the Father say, "Holy Ghost, go impregnate Mary for me"? Why would a father? No, see, it doesn't even make sense. It says right here very plainly, "The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore, that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God." So we find that it's talking about the holy which shall be born of thee. That is the Son of God. The Son of God didn't exist yet. The Son of God hasn't been conceived yet. The Son of God was prophesied. In prophecy, he existed. But as far as his actual appearance on earth, he did not exist yet. And he shall be called the Son of God. And one more thing I want to point out. It talks about overshadowing. That is definitely the presence of God coming on Mary. But that still doesn't explain the process, because it was the Word that was made flesh. And that word overshadow right there, it's not a mystery. It's the same word that was used when Jesus went up in the mountain and was transfigured and saw Moses and Elijah. And a few of the apostles were there, and Peter kind of woke up and said, "Wow, this is great, Lord. Let's just stay here a while. We'll build us a little area to stay." And a cloud overshadowed them. That's the same word right there. Whenever in the book of Acts, when Peter was walking along and people were being healed because his shadow fell on them, there wasn't anything special about the shadow. It's just that it overshadowed them, and his shadow passed by. So this isn't describing some supernatural something here that we can't understand. This is just a simple word, overshadow. It's the Word that created the miracle in her womb. Amen. Pastor?
No, go ahead.
Okay. All right. So next slide, please. And let me point out one more thing before we move too far along. It says on that slide before, it said, "And he shall be called the Son of God." It never says God the Son. And that's used so common in the church world today. God the Son, God the Father, God the Holy. That's not there. It's all made up stuff. Get your Bible and find it. Do a search. We challenge you. Do a search. It does not exist. It's made up. God the Son. It's the Son of God. People twist things, and they're able to bring in all kinds of heresies because of just a few words flipped around. Okay, so we're on the slide right now, John chapter 1, verse 14. Now, we've read this before, but we want to bring in some points here. Okay, the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So we see here that the Word is flesh. That is the Son of Man. And all the characters and the qualities of and the mannerisms that Jesus had that came out from his being, that is the Son of God. That is the Spirit of God at work in his life. And it's true for us too, Pastor.
Amen.
As men, as women, you know, we too are the son of men, or the women, the daughters of men. We too have the same constitution, physical constitution that Jesus had. I mean, he had ears, arms, legs, eyes, the hair, everything. So in that regard, we're just like him. As born-again believers, truly born again, filled with the Holy Ghost, walking before God with good conscience, blameless, we find ourselves that we're also able to be called a son of God, a child of God, a daughter of God, because we also fulfill through his Spirit that walks in us and works in us. We're born again. We can fulfill the very thing, the very life that Jesus lived when he was here on this earth. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
As a matter of fact, you can put two people side by side. And like I said before, you can figure out almost by looking at them just by how they dress what kind of person they are. And if you can't, just get them in a tight situation. You'll find out real soon. So next slide, please. Now, so what we're looking at here on this slide, it talks about God made creation to have a seed within itself. And we're looking at a slide there of some pecans and some apples, and the apples cut open. And Apostle Wendell Archie, he preached one morning and brought this point out so clear. I appreciate it so much. He actually cut an apple open there at the pulpit and explained this, and I pray to God I can explain it as well as he did. But all creation shows us God. As a matter of fact, in Romans chapter 1, it says that the invisible things of God are clearly seen by and are understood. The invisible things of God are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead. So we can look at creation and see how God works. And just by cutting open an apple, we can see how God works. So if we will, let's go to the next slide. So when God created things, he made them to show his character, how he operates. And what we're talking about here and where we're going is how Mary became pregnant, how that word became flesh. Because in Genesis 1 and 11, and God said, let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth. And it was so. So we see that when God created things, he made the seed to be in itself. That everything he created that is able to reproduce itself has a seed. And that's why we show the picture of the apple cut open there. Okay, next slide, please. So we should be where you're looking at the slide that said John 1, verse 1. And it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And verse 2 says, the same was in the beginning with God. Now we know that the Word, it says right here that the Word was God. So it's not talking about the Word having a beginning, because in Psalms 90, it talks about the before the mountains were made, or the earth was formed, or the worlds were formed. From everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. And we read right here in the verse that the Word was God. So we're not talking about the beginning of the Word. We're talking about the beginning of creation. But in this example here, we're seeing an apple with a seed inside of it. And when that apple was created by God from the very beginning, that seed was created in the apple. It's like somebody said, who came first, the chicken or the egg? Well, when God created the chicken, the egg was already there. I mean, the potential for that egg was there.
Yes.
It didn't come later. One evolved after the other. And so we see an apple here cut open and the seed inside of it. And I'm going to read in that part on the slide there where it's green. Let's read through that. And if you will, you can relate it to what's up in the verse, John chapter 1, verse 1. And it kind of makes sense. In the beginning was the apple seed. And the apple seed was with the apple. And the apple seed is an apple. And the fact that that seed is an apple, it can create more apples. It can create more trees. You can count, our chief apostle said one time, you can count the number of seeds in an apple, but you can't count the number of apples in a seed. Because you take that one seed and plant it, that one seed can generate one tree that can generate hundreds of apples, that can generate thousands of trees. So one seed can generate so many others. So, and that all the characteristics of that tree and the other apples are in that seed. That seed is the apple. As a matter of fact, the ovum, the egg inside the mother, is all human. It might be an egg, but that thing has all the characteristics. Now, it doesn't look human. The seed doesn't look like an apple tree. It doesn't look like it has arms and legs, and that seed doesn't look like it has the apple's flesh that you'd want to eat it. But everything there is about an apple is in that seed. And that's the way it is with the Word of God. So let's read this one more time. In the beginning was the apple seed. It was created with the apple itself. And the apple seed was with the apple, and the apple seed is an apple. The same was in the beginning with the apple. And that corresponds with the Word in John 1 and 1 that says, in the beginning was the Word, just like in the beginning was the apple seed, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. Pastor, would you care to share?
Okay,
all right,
yes,
praise God. So what we're finding here is that God has a seed in himself. God has a seed, and his word is that seed. And that's why it says that the word was made flesh. The apostles clearly understood what the significance of that word was. That word has creative power. That's why God could say, let there be light. And the word created that. The word created everything. Let the mountains, let the sea, let everything. I mean, everything God created, he did it by his word. He spoke his word, and his word performed it. Our words go as far as the sound waves. God's word is forever and ever. It has power and authority. It's quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. He can speak, and things will happen because his word will make it perform. When he said those words, that your womb will conceive, that word that he spoke that was given to the angel to tell Mary, that word had power to conceive. That word became flesh. It conceived in her womb. Amen.
Amen.
Next slide, please. So what we're talking about here is how the word became flesh. And the word is the seed of God. And that seed is what impregnated Mary's womb, that caused that egg to begin to develop and divide and become a human being. Okay, so on this slide, we're looking at Luke 8 and 10, verse 8 and 10. And in Luke 8, chapter 8, verse 4 through 8, it tells a parable about a sower that went to sow seed. And after Jesus had told the parable, the disciples came back and said, what were you talking about when you were saying that? We don't understand what you were trying to get at. We know you're trying to relate it to something here on earth, but what were you talking about? How does that relate to heavenly things? Well, in verse 10, Luke chapter 8, verse 10, Jesus said, this is Jesus talking, and he said, unto you it is given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, but to others in parables. I'm only talking to them about things of this world because they can't understand the kingdom. That seeing they might not see, and hearing they might not understand. But you know what? If those people had a desire to understand, God would open their ears. He would open their eyes. If any of the Pharisees, Nicodemus had a desire to understand. He even came and asked Jesus some questions.
Amen.
And Jesus plainly told him about this very thing in the Bible, being born again. So, you see, if a person has a heart to want to know God, to understand, God will open those eyes and open those ears. Otherwise, this is just a mystery. They hear it, they don't understand it. So let's look at verse 11. Now, the parable is this. So Jesus told the parable, right? Now he's explaining it. So this is no longer a parable. This is the fact. This is the way it is. The seed is the word of God. So he's not trying to say that it's like a seed or, you know, we're trying to show some example. Jesus is saying the seed is the word of God. That when that word is sown in your heart, it will bring forth life into you. It will bring forth change in your life. You'll be able to build a whole new life because that word is being built inside of you and growing in you, just like a newborn babe is growing inside of you. So Jesus answered the question right there. The seed is the word of God. Amen. And that's why the disciples and the apostles could say that the word became flesh and dwelt among us. Next slide, please. So here, another parable in Matthew 13, 24 through 30, Jesus tells a parable about the wheat and the tares. In Matthew 13, 37, he says, and he answered and said unto them, he that soweth the good seed is the Son of Man. And in 38, he says, the field is the world, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom of God, the children of the kingdom of God. But the tares are the children of the wicked one. You see, the seed is the word. And that's what he's saying, is that the good seed that the Son of Man sows through preaching. And we have many sons of men here, that preach. The Pastor Jonas and all the other pastors that you've seen throughout all this. These two are preaching the good seed of the word of God. And as that good seed is received into good soil, you'll find your life changing.
Amen.
So here in these examples, Jesus used the good seed, and he meant the word of God. We just saw that in a previous scripture. In the field of the world, the good seed are the children of the kingdom. So that's how we are born again. That's how we continue to grow, through that seed that is planted in our heart, the same way that the seed was planted in Mary's womb, through the word of God spoke that. Next slide, please. So here we are looking at the word becoming flesh. Well, see, the word needs to become flesh in us too. You know, we must be born again. And that's what the slide says. The word becoming flesh, we must be born again. Look at 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23. Being born again, okay, you're born of your dad, you're born and your mom. They're the ones that are your parents here on this earth. But there has to be another birth, a second birth that comes from God to be saved, to actually see the kingdom of heaven.
Amen.
Being born again, not of corruptible seed, not the ones that you started out with, not your friends, your neighbors, your teacher, all your buddies and pals that got you into trouble before. That's the corruptible seed. Your parents might have tried to lead you in the right direction and you went astray by listening to others. It's the words we hear, that the thoughts we accept that can corrupt our lives. That's the seed, the corruptible seed. All right, let me read one more time. Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible. What's incorruptible? By the word of God. Here we see it again, seed, word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. See, here again, it's saying that the word of God didn't have a beginning. It didn't have an end. Now in Mary's womb, when that word impregnated her, that was the beginning for the Son of God, the Son of Man. And let's read in 1 John chapter 3, verse 9. Whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin. Now, if God is in you, if you're acting out of the Spirit of God that's in you, how are you going to be sinning? I mean, Jesus Christ himself proved that you don't have to. It's a choice that we would make if we choose to sin. But it's not coming from that seed of God that gave birth in you. That's not where the sin's coming from. It's coming from this other part of you that is still struggling to die, and you must put it to death.
Amen.
So, verse 9, 1 John chapter 3, verse 9, whosoever is born of God does not commit sin, for his seed remains in him. For God's seed, the word of God, remains in him, and he cannot sin because he is born of God. Does that mean that as a person, I'm completely incapable, no matter how hard I try, I can't sin? For me, yeah, if I act in my will, but in God's will, if I follow God's will, it will never lead me to sin. I cannot sin following God's will. There's no sin that God will lead me to do. And from that, I can know for the rest of my life, walking in God, living in his word, doing everything he commands me to do, to be pleasing to my Father, I will never have to sin again. The Bible is full of if a man sins, if, but it never says that we shall or we have to. We don't Amen. Have to. We can be free of sin. Whoever is free of sin is free indeed. Amen.
Amen.
Pastor, do you have any follow-up?
Yes, sir. So as Pastor Lynn was saying there in 1 John 3 and 9, that if we're born of God, we do not commit sin, meaning habitually sin, because his seed, his word, remains in us. So I cannot habitually get mad, curse you out, have no problem with that, and say his seed is on the inside of me. That is not possible.
Amen.
Because the word of God, Christ, is going to rebuke me. He's going to bring to my mind what the word says, literally, bless and curse not. Say good versus something evil or versus something damaging. Bless and curse not. The word of God remaining mm-hmm. in me will not let me just go around practicing sin.
Amen.
No matter what it is, if I'm upset, I don't want to forgive you. If his seed, if his word remains in me, it's going to remind me. But don't you remember what Jesus said? That he gave the parable about the man who was forgiven by his Lord of a great debt, but then wouldn't forgive his fellow servant and took him by the throat and said, pay me that thou owest. And then it talks about when that man's Lord found that out, he took him, cast him into prison with the tormentors and told them that he had to pay off. And then he says, and likewise will my heavenly Father do to you also, if you don't, every one of you, forgive men of their trespasses from your heart. So the word of God abiding in me is not going to let me by with the sin of malice. It abiding in me is not going to let me by with not forgiving. His seed, that word, remains in me, and it's going to bring to the forefront of my mind what I'm doing wrong and what I need to correct.
Pastor Amen. Lynn. Excellent. Thank you, Pastor. That yes. was great. So I would just like to sum up something here. You know, people want to say, or religious people want to say, that Jesus had all the advantages because he was God's son. Well, so are you. If you walk in the Spirit, like Pastor Jonas was saying. But to credit Jesus with having some extraordinary power physically is wrong, because what that allows people to do, the tendency is to say, well, that's why Jesus didn't sin, because his flesh was different from our flesh. That's why Jesus didn't sin, because he had some physical advantage that he could just revert to the God side, get away from that man side. No, Jesus lived and walked and was wearied and sleepy and tired. The man was so tired, he was in a boat that was sinking, and they had to go wake him up. Jesus exhausted himself for our benefit. He lived in the body like we live in. The difference was from his beginning, even at the age of 12, he was determined to do his Father's will. And we must be the same way. And we'll find our lives, like Pastor Jonas so well said, we'll find our lives free of sin. We can do that. And we can do it through his word. He gave us the incorruptible seed in our hearts. Let's not live according to the old corruption. Amen. If you will, let's go to the next slide. That should be our last slide. And it's a homework assignment. If you will, we would like you to email this. The address is up there on the screen. If you will, go ahead and start writing it down now so you'll be sure to have it there. But what we're going to ask you to do is, during this lesson, we pointed out how Jesus, if you notice there in the small letters in blue, it says, if you're saved, you are a son of God. You're a child of God, daughter, son. Okay, if you're saved, you are a son of God, a child of God. You are also a son of man or a daughter of man. Okay, so you have the same two qualities that Jesus had. So, and you have that because you're human and you're born again of God's Spirit. So how does the Son of God and the Son of Man pertain to you? How do you find these two natures working in your life? Jesus had all the temptations that we have, and yet he was without sin. Why? Because he made that choice. So if you will, take a look at your life. And if you will examine yourself in the light of Jesus being all man, Son of Man, and also the Son of God, you can compare that. So what we're asking you to do is, how does that pertain to you? How does that help you when you're under temptation? How does seeing those two natures help you, knowing that Jesus was able to walk through this life also without sin? Amen. And if you will, just send that to the email address there, refugetempleministries@refugetemple.net. And I would like to encourage you one more time. If I remember to say it early, I mean to say it now. There's a real good video on the RTM group on YouTube called The Seed of God, The Seed, S-E-E-D, of God, which brings this point out very well. And it would be real good to see that. There's two parts there. Pastor Jonas?
Thank you, Pastor Lynn. And so one of the things that I love that you were talking about was Jesus not having an advantage over us. The Bible says that it behooved him, it benefited him for what God had called him to do and sent him to do here on earth, to be made like unto his brethren.
Amen.
He had to be given a flesh that hungers and thirsts just like ours. He had to be given a flesh that didn't want to die just like ours.
Amen.
He was in the Garden of Gethsemane praying because of that. He said, the Spirit indeed is willing. That Son of God was willing. He said, but the flesh is weak. He had to be given weak flesh just like us to understand us, to be able to succor or to comfort us, to help us, to aid us in our time of need. And that's what makes this understanding about him being the Son of God,
amen,
so important. It's because if you believe that he's God, he has the advantage.
Right.
Why? Because the Bible says that God cannot be tempted with sin, neither does he tempt any man with sin. So if you make him God, he was already at the advantage, and we already cannot live up to it.
Right.
But when we understand that he was the Son of God, tempted in every point like us, that makes the temptation real, because he had flesh like us. Right. He was a man like us. He could have given in and done wrong by choice like us. But if I make him God, he can't be tempted.
That's right.
With sin, whether he put on a body or not. If he's God, sin don't bother him, period. But in understanding he's the Son of God, made a little lower than the angels, made like you and I, to hurt, to cry, to suffer physically, then we understand, if I receive his Spirit, if that Spirit of holiness, that same Spirit resides in me, it can cause me to live like him as well. Then I can overcome sin. Then I can as the Bible, as he was saying about his disciples, that they were not of the world, even as he was not of the world.
Right.
We can get to that point and knowing, as he said, don't fear, I've overcome the world. That means if he was made like me, I'm his brother, he was given flesh like what I have, I also can overcome this world.
Thank you, Pastor Jonas. That was excellent. So we want to thank you for being with us today, and we pray that this has helped your walk with God to strengthen you. And we just want to close today in a word of prayer. And please be sure to tune in tomorrow. There's more of this at day three. And it is excellent teaching. Excellent. Praise God. So let's pray. Thank you, Lord God, for being with us today, God, and letting us be able to share this word, Lord. So few people hear this, Lord. It's rare in the earth today. We pray, God, that this word goes out and touches people's heart, that their lives are changed, God, that they can find strength in you, Lord, because your word, God, will grow in them like a seed would grow, Lord. Let your word just come into their hearts and lives, Lord. We pray this, God, to bless them and help them, Lord, and allow them, Lord God, to come back to see this yet another day, Lord. And we just give you all the thanks and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Paul wrote in Romans 1 concerning his son, Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. Now, you can help us in our efforts for bringing these life-changing broadcasts by texting RTMINC to 77977. And you'll get a link that looks like this. Your continued support is so greatly appreciated. Now, to learn more about God's Word, we invite you to visit our YouTube channel. And to help you on your journey, the new book written by Apostle Wendell Archie, Determining Truth from Error, is a must-have. Now, you can get your copy today from barnesandnoble.com or amazon.com. And if you'd like to talk to one of our prayer counselors, you can call us toll-free at 1-866-480-1949 or 281-441-1031. Thank you for tuning in today, and we invite you to tune in at the same time tomorrow. Until then, may God richly bless you. Let us
bring it up. Come on, sing to your Father this morning. Time crap.